The first Sunday of Lent, as we engage this journey to an empty tomb, to the resurrected Christ, and as we engaged and talked about on Wednesday night in our Ash Wednesday service, that the core truth of the good news is that we must give up. And not give up in the sense of this or that, but this time and this season is not about us getting more and more control of our lives, but giving up control. It's not about our commitment to God. It's about His commitment to us. And so we are in the book of Romans this morning. This is St. Paul's letter to the church in Rome, and we're going to read about it. Paul is a little different than the Gospels that we were in, and so I'm going to actually take some time. Paul kind of wages really theological in this passage, but I think if we take a step back and look at it in a summary-type way, we will see what Paul is talking about. He's going to talk about two men, two human beings in this passage, one whose name was Adam and one whose name was Christ. And we, in our stories and in our lives and in the worlds in which we live in, we're constantly, as Matt even talked about earlier, we talked about last week, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And Paul is writing to people that waver into whose story they end up living in. They live in Adam's story, but they belong to Christ, and we're called to live in His story. And so we're going to see the argument that Paul makes for life. Adam, death. Jesus, life. We're going to talk about this. Let me read here this text. You know the story of how Adam landed us in the dilemma we're in. Now, we are all in a dilemma. We've all been in a dilemma this week, and we live in this dilemma and this struggle that we're in. Well, we all know the story of how Adam landed us in the dilemma we're in. I'm always reminded of that phrase from The Lord of the Rings. I think it's Samwise Gamgee that says to Frodo, I think, I wonder what kind of tale it is that we have fallen into. What kind of tale have we landed in? Well, we have landed in the tale of Adam. And that's where he starts off. In the first sin, then death. And no one's exempt from sin. And none of us are exempt from actual literal physical death. And Adam's sin, and we're not going to talk a lot about it, but Adam's sin disturbed our relationship. And in Adam, we all fell. I've always thought that the one empirical evidence that I really believe bears true in Christianity is that we're all sinners. I mean, if you have a kid, you didn't even have to teach them. I mean, if you walked into our nursery right now, I bet you there's an argument over some toys. It's just our nature. It's what we do. Mine. It's one of the first words we hear, right? Mine. 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 That's the tale Adam landed all of us in. And you know what? We're adults now, but we're still saying mine, mine, mine. That sin disturbed relations with God and everything and everyone. It just messed things up. But the extent of that disturbance was not clear until God spelled it out in detail to Moses. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. So death, this huge chasm, abyss that's separating us from God, dominated the landscape from Adam and to Moses. Even those who didn't sin precisely the same way Adam did by disobeying specific commands of God, and he had to experience the termination of life, this separation from God. But Adam, who got us into this, also points us ahead to the one who will get us out of it. Yet the rescuing gift is not exactly parallel to the death-dealing sin. The gift of this one who's going to rescue us is not the same as the gift that Adam left us, which was sin. If one man's sin put crowds of people at the dead-end abyss of separation and created this chasm with God, just think about what God's gift poured through one man, Jesus Christ, will do. There's no comparison between the death-dealing sin of Adam and this generous, life-giving gift of Christ. The verdict on that one sin was the death sentence. The verdict on the many sins that followed was this wonderful life sentence. If death got the upper hand through one man, Adam's sin and wrongdoing, can you imagine the breathtaking recovery life makes? Sovereign life and those who grasp with both hands this wildly extravagant life gift, this grand gift that sets everything right that the one man Jesus provides. Here it is in a nutshell. One person did wrong and got us all in trouble, and another person did it right and got us all out of it. But more than just getting us out of trouble, he got us life. One man said no to God and put many people in the wrong, and one man said yes to God and put many in the right. All that passing laws against sin did was actually produce more lawbreakers. But sin didn't and doesn't have a chance in competition with aggressive forgiveness that we call grace. Sin does not stand a chance against the aggressive forgiveness of grace. When it's sin versus grace, grace wins, hands down. All sin can do is threaten us with death, and that's the end of it. Grace, because God is putting together everything together again through Jesus the Messiah, invites us to life, a life that goes on and on, world without end. That is the story of this scripture. It is a mouthful. It is a lot to think about. But I want to, just for a few brief moments as we come to this table, have us consider, what is it? What kind of tale have we fallen into? What kind of tale? We all, in a sense, got infected by Adam. And we are all and have lived in this world fearful and frightened. And I would even say, even this week, we've experienced some fearfulness and frightenedness. And for anyone who's lived, and maybe if you're kids or you're younger and you haven't lived, but I would even say to those who are kids and who are children here, we all live frightened with this thought. We all live in fear of this thought, that we are stuck. And no, we're not just stuck. We're actually stuck with ourselves. We're stuck with ourselves. And that's frightening, and that makes us afraid. Adam's dilemma, you can go back to the first slide because I'm going to kind of work through it. Adam's blunder, Adam's sin landed us into this dilemma that we're stuck in. That's what Paul's saying. We're stuck in this world. We're stuck with ourselves, and we're not happy about it, and I'm going to talk about that in a second, but we're stuck, and we can't escape. The death, and death here is not just physical death, but this life, you know, there's a comparison here, but by people in our stories, do we live stories that are life-giving, or do we live stories that bring chaos and bring into relationships? Our relationships end, our own feelings about ourselves leads to these places of darkness and despair. We're stuck with ourselves. And Adam's dilemma has landed in a place, as I've said in the last couple of weeks, we ate of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. We ate of this tree, and it told us what good and bad was. So now we're like God, but we're stuck because we're not God. We are now like God because we actually know good and we know evil, but we're stuck because we actually aren't God, and we're stuck and we can't get out of it. Now we're extremely frustrated.
frustrated.
We got the knowledge that God had. I mean, the serpent promised that, and it said their eyes were opened, and they knew good and evil. We actually know right from wrong, but we're not God, so we can't do it. We're stuck. We're stuck in this hamster wheel of life. It's like Groundhog Day. Have you ever seen that movie? You just wake up, and it seems like the same thing happens over and over and over again. And sin, and what sin has done in our own lives, and what sin did in Adam's lives, is it's actually disturbed our relationship with God in everything and in everyone. And the extent of that, and here is where Paul is going in this, because he talks about, you know what, before Moses came, there actually was no Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments that a lot of us are familiar with, for most of human history, if you look at the time when the people lived actually before Moses, didn't even have the Ten Commandments. But God, somewhere along the line in human history, decided to give us Moses. And in giving us Moses, he gave us the Ten Commandments. And people still disobeyed. Adam and Eve disobeyed God. Cain murdered Abel. And so there were bad things going on in the world. But at one point in time, God showed up, and he showed up on this mountain with Moses, and he gave Moses the law. And I love what the writer here of the Message says. What the law did is it made it clear how much our relationship has been disturbed with God. What may have seemed fuzzy about what was going on, God actually gave us his law. He gave us what he desired. He gave us his heart. And it was spelled out in detail. What Paul is saying is the law came to Moses, and now it made it more abundantly clear how we have fallen short. It's spelled out in detail how we're stuck. That's what the Ten Commandments did. The Ten Commandments just reveal that we're stuck. This is God's heart. This is what God's desire is for us. And we're stuck. And here's the tale of the two Adams, Adam and the second Adam, Jesus, at the other hand. So God comes and he reveals his will in his law in a mountain to Moses in the Old Testament. And you know what we did in our stuckness? You know what we did when we were stuck? We thought, wow, golly gee, God just gave us what he wants from us. God just gave us what his heart's desire. That's it. That's the path. That's the path to glory. I know exactly what God wants. He has spelled it out to me. I am going to recover the glory I've lost. You know what? I am stuck. I am stuck because now I know good and evil, and I actually know it now in more specific detail, and I know I'm not like God, but God's taken another step, and he's given me a little bit more detail, so this is going to be the avenue that's going to unstuck me. I'm not going to be stuck anymore, because golly gee, God spoke. Is golly gee, is that actually a violation of a commandment? Maybe, I don't know, I hope not. But man, the people of God said, wow, now we've got it. All we got to do is just, we know what God says, well, we'll just do it. And that's the path to life. In fact, he said it was the path to life. We don't have to be stuck anymore. We are stuck with ourselves. You know, if you fast forward to the day in which we live, go home today, turn on the TV, watch any ad that you see on TV, and you know what the premise and the foundation of every ad we see that's trying to sell us whatever is being sold? We know you're stuck. But here's the way out. I mean, we're inundated. diet programs. I'm stuck. My birthday's coming up, and my wife asked me what I wanted. I said, I want to lose 10 pounds. Can you do that? So I haven't had a meal since. No. You don't need to be stuck. You can be your own boss. You can work from home. I know you feel stuck. You feel stuck every day going to the workplace. You know, you're stuck. Some of you are now on fixed incomes. But here's an opportunity so you won't be stuck. I mean, we're always being offered to get out of our stuckedness. We just are stuck, and people are coming along, and they're offering it to us. You know, here's a drug that will improve your health, you know. I think we even come to church to get unstuck, right? You're hoping Pastor Brad will actually tell you something, will tell you some nugget of truth that will unstick your marriage and the rut you feel you're in your marriage, or it will unstick your parenting, it will unstick the lousy job that you have. You know, Pastor, just tell me something because I'm stuck. Just got some nuggets in here that could help unstick me. And then when you get later on in life, you know, so all of this, you're the forever young, we're going to be forever youthful. Then you get later on in life and you realize that you're stuck, and so then your body is failing and it hurts and you're stuck with a hurt body. So now we have Valium, which will unstuck the pain. We have Xanax that will unstuck the depression because we're stuck. I mean, it's just this vicious cycle that we all live in. We're stuck. We're stuck. And then God gave us his law, and we thought that was the answer, and we went for it, and we're finding we're stuck. Let me say that in the reality that we're stuck, there's actually something heartily good about you and I feeling stuck. Because what it reveals is our hearts know that we're not home. Our hearts are longing for something that is genuine and true. Our hearts are longing for a reality that we know must be out there. And what Paul is going to come along and say is, you know what, you have these genuine longings, and then God and Moses spell it out in a much clearer way, in a much clearer path. But if you actually read the Old Testament people of God, they had this positive view of what God had done in displaying his law, and they were going to go for it for all his might. But what Paul is saying is, you know what, the law came, and the one man, Adam, and those who followed Adam, they wanted to recover and get out of being stuck. And then they took the law, and Paul is actually saying to him, you know what the problem was? Is the problem is the law, the declaration, the details that God gave to us on Sinai. They're not the solution for us being stuck. In fact, they're actually the problem. It's the problem. Here's what happens. There is a man named David in the Old Testament. I'm going to try to show you what the purpose of God's law that Paul's talking about here is. There is a man named David, and he was a king in the Old Testament. And David was a great king. He was called a man after God's own heart. During the course of David's story, this was the man after God's own heart, he actually fell in love with a woman that was married to some other man. But you know what happened? Because he was the king, you know, he, one, took her anyway, and two, he was stuck, okay? David was stuck. And so David took the woman, but that was a problem, and he needed, because he was going to find life in the law, right? And the law says you can't do that. It says you can't commit adultery. So David says, I know how I can't commit adultery. Her husband is an officer in the army, and I'm going to put him in the front row, and he's going to get killed. And then I won't be committing adultery. I will be following the law. And so that's exactly what he did, and her husband died. And David took Bathsheba. David, it must seem that they think he's doing hey-okay because he's just going on with life. I think he probably found the loophole, as we always will in the law of God. And so he finds this loophole, and so he's going on. He doesn't seem to think he's done anything wrong. And God sends this prophet to Nathan, or to David, and his name is Nathan. Oh, hi, Nathan. Yeah, you're a prophet of God. Come tell me a story. And so Nathan comes and tells Nathan a story about this rich man who was very, very rich. And he had, his house was open, and a poor man came into his house who had nothing, had very little. He had very, and that day you had cattle and sheep and these things. And in order to feed themselves that evening, the rich, rich man took nothing of what he had. He actually took the one little thing the poor man had. And he took it away from the poor man, and that's what they used for dinner. And David rages. That person should be crucified. That person's terrible. That person should have to give back fourfold of what they took. Who would do something like that? And Nathan said, you are that man. And of course, that broke David. It's what the law does. What we came and God gave to us that we want to cling to, and we think we can do, that puts us on the Groundhog Day and the hamster cycle over and over again, was actually given to us to actually tell us, you are that man and you are that woman. You all have fallen short of the glory of God. What Paul is saying is the law came and we all became umpires. We're just umpires. And when you live in the world of umpiring and relationship, strike one. Strike two. Strike three. Sometimes we don't even get to strike three. You're out. Paul is saying that in Adam, there is death because our umpiring always leads to death. What he says here, and you can go to 15 and 17. There is that way of Adam. There's that way of following the law. He actually finally goes down into verse 20. He leaps ahead, and you can leap ahead, and I'll go right back. He leaps ahead, and he says, all the passing laws did, all that God did when he came to Sinai, all he did was actually just produce more lawbreakers. We just knew more ways in which we were disobeying God. What the law does. You want a rule book? See, we get excited about the rule book because all of a sudden we can keep the rules. And God says, well, no, the rule book increased to actually show you that you keep messing up more and more and more and more and more. How morbid is that? But there's something even greater than this. There's something greater than Adam. Adam left us with the gift of sin, but Jesus has come. And guess what? He's left us with the gift of life. It's a gift. You can go back to 15 and 17. It's a gift that overwhelms. And one of the things that Paul's saying, you know, Adam left us a sin, and that's really, really bad. But you know what? You know what? Jesus has come and offered a free gift, and that free gift, what Adam did, doesn't hold a candle to Jesus. What Jesus did overwhelms Adam. This isn't just tit for tat. You know, Jesus came and or Adam came, and the sins of the world are not there much more than this, but the sins of the world are 3 million sins. And Jesus is going to come and he's just going to undo 3 million sins, and that's just what he did. No, it's like the sins of the world were 3 million, and Jesus comes and offers us glory and offers us his righteousness, which is 3 trillion. It's overwhelmingly different. It's overwhelmingly greater. It's out of proportion to what Adam did. What Adam did was bad, but what Jesus did was greater. You really want to know what all of this back and forth means? It's this in the passage. What Adam did was bad, and he put us in a dilemma, and we're stuck. But what Jesus did is infinitely greater than what Adam did. That's the good news of the passage. That's the good news of what death had the upper hand, but Jesus is breathtakingly better. He even goes on to say in this text that Adam put us in the situation, but Jesus got us out. But Jesus didn't just get us out. He got us out and gave life. Go to verse 17. Yeah, there it is. You were right there. I'm going to go back to that slide, and then we're going to read right through to this slide. It says, if death got the upper hand through one man's wrongdoing, can you imagine the breathtaking recovery life makes? Can you imagine that Adam, though he sinned, can you imagine the breathtaking recovery that life makes, sovereign life, in those who grasp with both hands this wildly extravagant life gift, this setting, grand setting, everything right thing that one man Jesus provides? If Adam provided us with sin, what Jesus provided with us is breathtaking. It is meant so that our lives, even in our feeling stuck, would be meant to be breathtaking. Adam got us into trouble. And when I used to read this passage, I used to think, well, Jesus got me out. There's the exchange. It's some legal arrangement. Adam got me sin. Jesus got me righteousness. And it was imputed, and I stopped there. And by the way, that is the core truth of why Jesus plus nothing is everything and the reality. But the core truth and the reality is that Jesus not only got me out, he gave you and me life. Paul asks us, can you imagine the breathtaking recovery? And that breathtaking recovery can only be imagined, not through a set of facts, but through a person, Jesus Christ. Our struggle in all of our relationships, and as we come to the table, I'm just going to share a piece of my story. The question I, even as I read through this and was thinking about what the law offers and what God's outrageous grace offers, is here's how we know we live according to Adam. We live according to the law. I pretty much was raised in Christian schools. And one thing I learned, at least in the Christian school, in the Christian schools that I attended, when I was being raised, and I don't think it's just Christian schools, it's sometimes the larger body of Christ, but one thing I learned really quick is that I would be loved based upon what I did, not who I was. I was always loved based upon what I did and how I behaved. I was never loved for who I was. Never. And guess what a smart little boy does when he knows he's going to get love based upon what he does and not who he is? You know what a little boy does, at least with my personality? He performs. To get the love. And guess what happens when I perform? And I'm really smart. I know I can't perform well enough. In fact, there were times I didn't, and guess what? I felt the rejection. I felt the casting off. I felt the shame. And so I don't want to feel shame, and I don't want to feel afraid. So when I knew I couldn't perform, that's what I did. I pretended. I put on masks. I lived a lie. The way of Adam says that we will be loved based upon what we do, not who we are. My whole life. life. It was a life of performance and shame, and eventually I hated myself because I couldn't perform. Even when other people thought I was performing and I was receiving their so-called love, I hated myself because I knew I was not. Because the law kept showing up and telling Brad, you are that man. You're that man. You may have, you know, you may have gone and capitulated to some external form of circumstances that make teachers happy, that make people happy, but I know and you know that you are that man. Listen, I still struggle with that today. I still struggle with me. It still holds me. You know, I can have a bad week at work. And here's what happens when I have a bad week at work. Oh, I didn't call them, and I should have called them. Oh, I know they were sick, and I didn't call them. They called me, and they wanted their prayer request put out to everybody, and I forgot to tell Amy, and I didn't do it. Oh, I could have done this better. Oh, I could have done that better. That's the world in which we live, right? We're all umpires. And the reason I felt that growing up is because the teachers and the people in authority were the umpires, and they actually weren't just waiting to call strike one, strike two, strike three, we're out. You know what we do in the church? We actually sneak around and our umpires, we go out of our way. We're like the cops. We're the secret cops. Strike one. Strike two. I mean, it's what the church does. Did you hear about that? You can't tell anybody because she doesn't know. And we do that, and we still do it. We still umpire, and we say strike one, strike two, strike three, we're out. That's the world in which we live. And Paul is saying that world is death. It will always lead to death. Always. And you say, well, Brad, you can't say that, because if I can't umpire you, then I can't make you behave. That's exactly why we do it, right? We umpire so that we can extrapolate the behavior out of our kids. We can extrapolate the behavior out of the pastor. We can extrapolate it. We become umpires. And Paul is saying that is not the breathtaking life that is offered in Christ. Paul is saying that the law says you are that man. And then he says that Jesus showed up and says, I'm the man. I'm the man. And what Adam did doesn't hold a candle to what I've done. And all of your umpiring, and all of your calling balls and strikes, it leads to death. But here's what Jesus will offer. Jesus will offer, because we're still all lawbreakers, right? I can still have a bad week at work. I was never going to be that perfect little kid. But Jesus offers grace. And our sin doesn't hold a candle to God's grace. That's what this passage says. That where sin abounded, grace went crazy. It's what it says in the text. Probably not in this text, but where sin abounded, grace much more. Literally, grace went wildly crazy. Grace are hypered it. People come to me and say, Brad, you preach hyper-grace. Well, one, Paul actually says the word hyper-grace here. And listen, if grace isn't hyper, if it's not exaggerated, if it isn't more outrageous, there isn't a person in this room that stands a chance. Because I know I don't. See, when we actually take the good gift of God's law and actually try to get unstuck by obeying, you know who Jesus is? He's just a cheerleader. I can preach to Brad. You can come to Brad this week. Brad, you can do it. You can do it. You can make that call. Brad, you can do it. But if the law is really what it says it is and it cannot unstuck it, Jesus is not our cheerleader. Jesus is our Savior. Jesus isn't our cheerleader. He's our Savior. And by the way, as our Savior, he just wildly loves us. We have no greater cheerleader than Jesus. Because he loves us. Jesus didn't come to cheer. He came to forgive. And he can say in Romans 8, there is now no condemnation to that little boy who sought love by what he did. There's no condemnation. My teachers may condemn me. Friends may condemn me. People may condemn you. But there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. You say, but Brian, you can't say that. Because the only way I can get you to do what I want is if I condemn you. Do you see how we do it? We take all the power away from our parenting, right? We take all the power away from doing church. Yes, because Lent is about giving up that control and trusting. Trusting in the man that as the little boy screws up, or the pastor screws up, that because Jesus is the man, I'm going to trust his heart, not my condemnation. And you know what this passage does? It strips all of our power away, and we live, the reason our advertisers give it to us, and the reason it so works, because we live in America, and we believe in the power of our voice. We do believe in the power of the voice with the good news, but it's the voice of Jesus who says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy, and I will give you rest. Because you know what? When I am really mad, and I want to condemn my kid, I want to bring shame on my kid, I want to instill fear in my kid's heart, you know who has the problem? I do. Not my kid. My rage and my condemnation reveals that the problem is mine. Because I'm afraid of something. I'm not going to trust my kid's heart to God. But if I live out of no condemnation, I need not condemn. I need not rage. It doesn't mean that I can't share my heart with my child and talk about paths that people walk that lead to life and lead to death. But all of the control I seek, I don't have. Because Jesus is the man. The table that we are going to partake of is part of the story. This table is breathtaking. The body of Christ shed for you, or broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The man. The tale of the second Adam. The one who says, I am that man, has offered you his body. And has offered you his blood so that you can know that you are not condemned today. You know, I grew up and this table was a table of condemnation. I couldn't even come to the table because I felt so condemned. This table is the table of no condemnation. It's for us to realize that it's not about our performance. It's not about what we do. It's about what Jesus done. We've taken both baptism and the Lord's Supper. We've taken these sacraments and we've made them all about us and what we've done. Neither of these are about what we have done. They're about what God did and is doing and will do in our hearts and our lives. And when we come and we experience, this table is meant to nourish us and remind us that we're in no condemnation. You think, well, how do I live? How can I not condemn my child? Well, you know, you probably could die and you won't do it anymore. But part of the nourishment that you get, part part of what Jesus gave to us is to remind the most perfect father in the world reminds his children that they have no condemnation, so that we will be empowered. We will be unstuck by this table and by the work of Christ, so that we don't have to be condemned, because we don't have to condemn because we weren't condemned. The most perfect father in all of the universe. Every one of his kids is rebellious. See, when our kids go rebellious, we think it's all about us. Our Heavenly Father says no. The most perfect father in the universe, every one of his kids is rebellious. And it's his kindness, not his condemnation, that leads us to repentance. Who is this table for? Well, if you say that you have no sin and that you're not one of his rebellious children, the table's not for you because you're a liar. That's good. It's John. I'll just put it bluntly. He who says he has no sin is a liar. So if you think you're not one of God's rebellious kids, then don't come. Don't make a mockery of what he's done. But if you are one of his rebellious kids, run. Run to this table. Run to the gospel. Run away from the condemnation of the law. And meet the man. And taste of his broken body. And taste of his shed blood. It will be breathtaking. And your recovery of those places of your rebellion will be breathtaking. The only hope for your recovery is in this table. It's in the man Christ Jesus, whose grace is greater than our sin. Well, you know, as I was thinking, as I was partaking and people were coming forward, you know, I told you a little bit about my story. But the reality is, everything was consistent. The only way I could come to the table and for Christ to love me at his table was not for who I was, but if I had performed. If I hadn't performed well enough, I actually couldn't sit with my Savior. And I couldn't eat at my dad. One man who loves you because of what he did. And because of what he did, he loves you for who you are, a sinner in the need of grace. That will set you free. It did me. It's still setting me free. I needed the table this week. I desperately needed to know that my Father loves me because of what he's done. Go in peace because he loves you wildly, and your sin can't hold a candle to his grace, because for where your sin abounds, grace